So, Alice Reeves, come all the way from Brighton today, which is fabulous dedication. And I'll leave her to explain about herself and what she does.
Hi, good morning, everyone. How are we? Good? Good, I've had two coffees this morning, so fantastic. So, thank you so much, William, for inviting me to speak today. A lot of the comments that you made in your opening statement fit perfectly into what I'm going to be speaking about, so I have no idea how you did that. We didn't collude. A little bit about me before I start speaking. So my name is Alice Reeves. I run a digital marketing agency called The Joyful Web based in Brighton, and I've worked in social media professionally for about the last 10 years. And also, as a sort of passion project of mine, I run an event called BelongCon, or the Belong Conversation, which is every few months in Brighton, we invite a panel of speakers to come along and share their stories of finding belonging in the world, finding community, finding self-acceptance, and the positive difference that's made in their lives. And so today, I'm going to be talking a little bit from my experience as a social media professional, from my experience as an avid social media user personally, and also from organising the BelongCon events. There is absolutely no denying that the rise of social media has completely transformed the way that we communicate and connect with each other. And in some ways, this has been really, really positive. I mean, I wouldn't have a business if social media didn't exist. I wouldn't have made a lot of the friends I've made if social media didn't exist. But that isn't to say that social media isn't without its problems. Our lives, in a lot of the ways that William described, have become increasingly digitized over the last 10 years. And it does feel a lot of the time like that increases the distance between us. I read a stat the other day from last year that the average smartphone user spends 5 hours a day looking at their phone screen, and 2 of those hours are spent on social media and networking apps. There's been a lot of kind of rise in different ways to use social media over the last year, so I would be surprised if that hasn't even increased further. And a lot of people, especially young people, and even though you might argue at the age of 31, I maybe can't call myself a young person anymore, but particularly people around my age and younger, we actually prefer to communicate digitally than face-to-face or on the phone. When I was a teenager, I remember pestering my parents to use the landline and talking for hours and hours and hours to my friends. And then somewhere along the way, in my early 20s, I just stopped talking to people on the phone. I started to text. Facebook happened. And then it was all public conversations on each other's walls. And in anything I'm saying today, of course, I don't want to come across as being ableist, because I completely understand that for a lot of people who have social anxiety or disability, social media can be a lifeline. And I'm not bashing social media because, as I said, it's my profession. I rely on it heavily and I use it every day. And it's an important channel for a variety of reasons. It can bring people together offline. It's encouraged a huge amount of awareness and activism. So I'm not going to be bashing social media. And despite its problems, I am incredibly optimistic about the trends that I'm observing in how people are using the digital space. So what I'm going to be talking about today are a couple of shifts that I've been observing personally and professionally in the way that people use social media. So instead of broadcasting out to these huge undefined audiences, both individuals and businesses are starting to form and seek out communities online through the rise of things like Facebook groups and private messaging apps. And people seem to be starting to create these communities to belong to, that know each other and that support each other, instead of having these kind of standalone conversations where people are just projecting out an image of themselves. And what's also really interesting in terms of recent changes to social media is the rise of video, in particular live video, where people can have real-time conversations with each other via social channels. And alongside that, there's been a huge trend towards disappearing content. So things like Instagram and Snapchat, where messages either disappear after a set time or after viewing. And these formats, interestingly, replicate conversation in a way that when Facebook first started, it really didn't. And despite this, a question I've been asking myself a lot is, even though the way that we use social media is changing, to what extent can real life ever be reflected digitally? To what extent can me having a one-to-one conversation, looking at a person's face, be replicated online? And I think it's so important, especially with the people in the room today, and as William touched on, that as much as I love social media and as much as it has its benefits, it can be really damaging, especially for young people. And I tried to kind of look for some stats, and after a quick Google, I was just drowning in, you know, figures about how depression's been linked to depression, anxiety, body dysmorphia in young people. And, you know, it really is no wonder. I certainly know that when I was young and I was growing up, just the kind of photoshopped images in beauty magazines were enough to make me feel really bad about myself within about 10 minutes of picking one up. And now, as William said, absolutely every single person with a smartphone can edit, can crop, can re-angle their photos before they post, so that it looks nothing like reality. And that ability to edit ourselves, but more than that, the need that many of us, myself included, feel to edit ourselves, is really fundamentally what stops our social media presence and our reality from matching up. Because you can take the absolute perfect minimalist Instagram flat lay in the messiest house, or choose one good selfie out of hundreds, and people will look at that and go, oh, they look good. Oh, their house is amazing. Oh, I bet they're having an amazing life. And then compare themselves to that, and that can result in a huge amount of negative feelings. But like the shift that we're seeing from broadcasting on social to seeking out these private groups and communities, there is also a trend that is starting online towards more authentic presentation, particularly amongst young women through the body positivity movement. Recently, I had a detox of my Instagram feed, where I went through and I got rid of all of the accounts I was following that continually presented me with this unattainable ideal. Because even though they were supposed to be inspiring, they weren't inspiring me. I realized that they were making me feel pretty crap about myself. And that's me as a 31-year-old woman. You know, I was really shocked to observe the impact that following these sorts of accounts had on me. And I thought, God, just imagine what that must be like for a 15-year-old, putting myself in that place to be seeing these images of unattainable perfection everywhere. And what it also made me realise is, looking inward at myself, how great I had become at curating myself online to make it look like I had everything handled, that everything was awesome, you know, to kind of, you know, not consciously, unconsciously, edit out the struggles, edit out the bad days, and just show the editing highlights. When the reality is that I'm human, I'm flawed, and some days are pretty damn tough. But I don't talk about those online. And in fact, it's sharing those days when things aren't going great that make the biggest difference to people, and that open up these opportunities for genuine connection. It's being authentic, it's being vulnerable, and it's using your online presence to show people that they're not alone. And personally now, I'm starting to pay a lot more attention to the way that I present myself online and how others present themselves online. And organizing the LongCon has been a huge catalyst for that. Now, it's true that much like this, it's an offline event that gets people into a room to speak and to share. But its online presence is also essential. So we use social media to promote the event, about to do our fourth one. They all sold out. We live stream parts of the event on Facebook, and we upload the speakers' talks, unedited, as they were presented in the room, to YouTube, to Facebook, and then they're shared online, both by the speakers, by the friends, by the family, and by attendees. So it really does cross the online and the offline worlds. And the things that our speakers talk about at these events, to a room full of strangers, have included things like mental health, grief, homelessness, activism, spirituality, gender, childhood trauma, loneliness. They're all real life problems. And we create this safe space offline for people to talk, to share, to connect face to face. And then we use the social media presence that LongCon has to bring those conversations online. And so I think even without realizing what I was doing at first when I started to organize these events, in the LongCon I have created what I feel is a complete antidote to the edited, curated, filtered social media presence that a lot of us feel the need to design, sometimes without even realizing that's what we're doing. And these events really have been life-changing, and you know, people have used those words to me, they've said those words to me after attending. They prompted confessions that people have never made publicly, and I've watched as those confessions made in that event have transformed not only something offline in that moment, but then the way those people who are public figures who have a strong presence then go on to present themselves online as well. And so, in summary, when it comes to social media, we really, really need to get real. We need to have more authentic conversations, not only out in the world, but online in the digital space. And collectively, it feels like right about now, a lot of us have had enough of sitting behind our computer screens. I did that kind of through my 20s. Facebook came into existence when I was at university. So for all of my professional life, I have had that online. I've had that online presence, which has been my dominant form of communication. I downloaded this app called Moment. If you're curious about how long you spend looking at your smartphone screen, that really scarily will tell you. And that 5 hours a day, it really isn't far off. So now we really are craving that community, online and offline. We're learning to recognize when information is filtered, when it's inauthentic. And I think it's time that we start calling that out and that we check ourselves on it too. So instead of only posting on social media when everything's going great or you've got good news or it's really exciting, let's start sharing when it's not so great. Not in like a whingy way, not in a fishing for sympathy, everything is awful way, in a powerful, tell-it-like-it-is way. Because when we do, we find that realness, we find that connection, and we can sometimes find humour in what feels like a really desperate situation. We feel less lonely, we feel more connected, and we find that common ground together. And that is how supportive communities that make a positive, genuine difference are formed. Thank you.
I've got a question. I'd like to know a bit more about the LongCon
okay. And
what the people who come to the LongCon are looking for and what they get from the LongCon.
Oh, that's a tough one. So Pippa here is currently redesigning my the LongCon website for me, and we've had a lot of conversations about this. When I started the LongCon, it stood for the Belong Conference, and I marketed it as a conference that was all about community acceptance and belonging. And when, after we'd done the first event, I realised that it didn't feel like a conference, it felt like a conversation, it felt like a series of conversations. So then I started to refer to it as the Belong Conversation, which is handy because I didn't need to change the name. So I think people come a lot of the time because of the themes that the speakers are addressing. So I will put out online in advance of the event, a description of each of the speakers' talks, who they are, link them in, encourage them to share to their networks. I also sometimes ask speakers to film a little video of themselves talking about either what they're going to be talking about or what belonging means to them. And so I think people come to hear specific speakers a lot of the time. And I think that what people go away with is something really different to what they were going there, which was to hear a speaker. And, you know, I've had people come out and say, you know, that event literally changed my life. Hearing that person speak, I've realised that I can start my own business, or actually I'm really lonely and I don't have any friends and I feel really passionately about this, so I'm going to start a community group about it. I met my business partner through doing BelongCon, because she came along to an event and just came up to me and said, I need to know you, let's have a talk. And then she spoke at the next event, and now we run a business together. People have formed friendships, relationships. It really does just provide a safe space for people to be open and be vulnerable. And I think a lot of people that come are not used to hearing people stand up and sharing themselves like that. And then at the end, we have half an hour kind of conversation where people from the audience can stand up and they can either ask questions or they can share something that's opened up for them through the course of hearing the speakers. So it's a little bit magical, actually, and I feel like a bit of a bright and hippie for saying that, but the atmosphere that we create, that our speakers create, is something that I never expected when I first put the event on.
Okay, your question is back there. And your analysis of the problems and benefits of social media, fascinating. I think that you've identified the issue. How do we actually get to the youngsters who need our help?
In terms of how do you access them?
Yeah.
I think obviously through kind of publicising services like signpost offers, I think what's really important is firstly for the people that have access to young people, that are talking to young people, is just to continually be reiterating that message that anyone can present themselves online in any way they want. It will be filtered, it will be curated, it will be a conscious choice. You know, in the same way that, you know, television is not real, beauty magazines are not real, we now have that technology. Anyone can essentially do a live TV broadcast or upload a video. So I think just being responsible as adults for sharing that message that what people see online is not real. And I think as well, in our own social media presence, when we're sharing, being real, not contributing to that culture of filtering, of editing, of only sharing positive messages, of sharing a balanced view in ourselves, and being responsible social media users. And, you know, I think that's what it comes down to, is that we need to be leading the charge in the messages that we're putting out there, so that the authenticity eventually drowns out the inauthenticity. And I think people are getting wiser now to knowing what's real and what's not.
So it's a kind of fake news formula to social media.
Completely.
Sorry for another question.
I mean, personally, I don't work with young people. I think it would be great to kind of, you know, collectively put those guidelines together, like to get a group of, you know, all adults to kind of, you know, lay out what does it look like to be a responsible social media user. I mentioned before the body positivity movement. And I think that directing young people to people like Megan Crabb on Instagram, who I follow, who is her Instagram name is Body Posy Panda. She's in her 20s, and she talks a lot to young people about body positivity. So she overcame an eating disorder and now is just a normal size woman. And what she shares is always so authentic, inspiring, uplifting. She has a lot of young fans. And I think a big part of of how we're kind of guiding young people to use social media is to follow the people and look at the presences of the people that are using it as a force for good, and kind of make, you know, I think it's a lot of it is about educating kind of, you know, what is that toxic social presence? What does that look like? What are the tricks that people use in terms of lighting, editing, to make their pictures look more enhanced than they actually are? So in short, I don't have those guidelines. I feel like that is something that should exist. And I feel like, you know, the people that have that contact with young people, you know, could, you know, maybe it's an idea to actually have a workshop with social media professionals, you know, and I would happily put myself forward for that, to look at how you can address it in an online campaign that reaches those people. You know, if the teenagers are using Snapchat, if they're using Instagram stories, what does a wider campaign look like to reach those people? And, you know, how can we be a force in driving that?
I just got one more question, I'm sorry. I just wondering if you could talk a bit more about how you, I think you said this earlier when you were talking about how being gets people together into a room and you kind of have an offline conversation about something, maybe anxiety or something, and then you put it out on the online. Could you just say a bit more about how?
Yeah, so I don't know who is familiar with TEDx or has watched TED Talks on YouTube. So I have somebody filming at each event, filming the talks, and we don't edit them before we put them online. We take them exactly as the speaker delivered them. We kind of top and tail with a slide that says, you know, who they are. And then we upload that direct to YouTube, direct to Facebook. We send the talks out to the speakers. We encourage them to share that with their networks. So, you know, we're not contributing to that edited presence. None of it is edited. We also Facebook live stream whichever speakers are comfortable with having their talk live. So anyone that can't make the event can watch online really as it's happening. So I think it, you know, it is just a case of sort of saying that what happens on offline in this space is exactly what we're putting online. We're not filtering. There's no pretense. It is just as it is.
Hi, I've just got a quick question for you. And you mentioned at the beginning of your talk about your Instagram detox. That you're starting to unfollow certain people on Instagram. And I've certainly noticed myself, just personally, and the people around me over the last couple of months even, that I think a lot more people are being a bit more, becoming more, I don't know, the word disillusioned, probably more illusioned around what's happening on Facebook, what's happening online, particularly now with the, Cambridge Analytica, thank you. And what I'm noticing a lot of friends coming off of Facebook now, deleting Messenger, and actually being a lot more critical and careful around social media. So I'm wondering whether at some point people are going to go the other way and start to connect more person to person than they are online. And I'm just wondering, have you experienced that, or what are your thoughts on that?
There's just been a report issued by We Are Social about global online trends in social media. It's grown again in the last year. So social media usage is still increasing. I think people are starting to diversify what platforms they use. And certainly my friends who are coming off Facebook are not coming off Twitter, are not coming off Instagram. They're just coming off that platform, or they're saying, oh, I'm deleting the Facebook app, but I'm going to keep the Messenger account. So I definitely think, you know, people are waking up to how their data is being used. Personally, you know, I run a business. All of my personal data is online. Like, it has to be. Anyone can find out anything about me by Googling. I've also worked in Facebook marketing for about 10 years, so I'm fully aware of the targeting options that are available within the ads dashboard and the sort of, you know, the ways you can target people by political view, by income, by household makeup, by purchase behaviour. But it's insane. And you know, the Cambridge Analytica stuff is a shock, but to someone that's worked in digital for 10 years, I really wasn't surprised that that sort of thing was happening, sadly. It was just a matter of time before it broke. But I, like I said, people are, what's really interesting is instead of just broadcasting out on the Facebook feed, like, here's what I did today, here's what I had for breakfast, here's me and my fiance walking on a beach in the Bahamas, and then everyone's going, hey. You know, what people are doing now is forming these communities through Facebook groups. So I'm in a number of communities for like women who work in digital, you know, Pinner, who's going to Brighton Girl in a bit, they've got closed Facebook group where which you can join, and then there's a community of women in Brighton that talk. I'm forming my own little groups on messaging apps, on WhatsApp, for friends I know from a certain context. So people are kind of seeking out those private pockets rather than just broadcasting out.
Okay, so it's great, we've got questions. We've got one last one, if we can make this a little quick.
So do you think that Instagrammers, YouTubers, that kind of thing, have a moral or social responsibility to present that in their images in the same way that magazines have to say that it's like a requirement that a magazine has to say that its image is photoshopped? Do you think that the Instagrammers should have a responsibility to also say that?
Yeah, I do. In short, and I think for the sake of the mental health of young people who are looking at those images, you know, you see a beauty ad and it's for mascara and there's like, these are not the model's own eyelashes. And I'm like, oh, why are you telling me? But yeah, I do think we are going that way, and I would really like to see a kind of, if not legally enforceable, but at least a code of conduct in place that acknowledges people take responsibility for how they present themselves.
Okay, thank you very much, Alice. We can give her a